Have you ever wondered what it would be like to live without electricity? Your home would be dark without light bulbs, cold without electric heat. You wouldn't have a television, a refrigerator, a stove, or even running water. Farmers living in rural Georgia didn't begin to get electricity until the late 1930s, over 40 years after Atlanta and other cities had already received it. And life without power was full of hardships.
In the early 1900s, electricity in Atlanta was cheap because there were lots of people there to pay for it, which lowered the cost. City dwellers were enjoying new appliances and lights in their stores and homes. But for rural Georgians, electricity was only a distant dream. Power companies didn't want to pay the cost of bringing electricity to rural areas where people lived too far apart. It was too expensive to build lines for only a few customers per mile. And besides, poor farm families couldn't afford the high electric bills. Out of every 100 farms in Georgia, only 3 had electricity. So most farmers remained isolated. With only kerosene lamps to light their way, a farm family's life was anything but easy.
Summer and winter go by, but the water has to be pumped and the fire lighted. This is 1940, but the farm woman's day is long. They don't complain, women like Hazel Parkinson, but they know on an August morning how hot the stove is going to be at noon. They may not say much about it, but they wish you could just turn a faucet to get your water the way you can in town. They know, and their children know, the work that goes into raising food for a nation.
Much of a farm family's daily income depended upon how many containers of milk they were able to sell to the local dairy. Without electricity, there were no refrigerators to keep milk from spoiling.
But this hot day, there's something wrong. It's hard to cool milk right in August if you haven't the right sort of pump or equipment. Milk today must pass modern standards, dairy standards. Sour milk, good for pigs. The milk check won't be so big this month.
But there was no time to dwell on setbacks. There was always work to be done on the farm, and that meant everyone pitching in, even the kids. No electric tools meant that farm work took more time, more muscle, more sweat. And farm women worked equally as hard. They didn't have washing machines, sewing machines, or electric stoves. What kept them going was their strength and their dedication to their families. Author Terry Kay grew up on a farm in Hart County, Georgia, with his 11 brothers and sisters. His family didn't get electricity until 1947, when he was 10 years old.
We had the iron stove, and we had kerosene lamps and battery-powered radios. So it was a difference. But besides that, there was a perceived difference in class, that we were the inferior class because we didn't have those things. And the kids that did have them, they were considered to be the superior class.
Without the modern conveniences of today, what was life really like for kids who grew up without power in rural Georgia?
This is kind of cold in here, isn't it?
It's freezing.
Well, how do you heat this place? Oh. Come with me, we got some work to do.
When kids weren't in school, they were expected to help out, and that meant chopping a lot of wood. A fire in the fireplace was the only way to keep your family warm in the cold months. But wood was needed every day, even in the summertime. You couldn't just pop your food into an oven like we do today. The cooking had to be done over an open fire or on a wood-burning stove. And since there were no electric water heaters, a fire was the only way to warm water for washing clothes or taking a bath, and that could be a chilly experience. And getting water wasn't easy. No electric water pumps meant no indoor plumbing. You couldn't just go to the sink and turn on the faucet. You had to go out to the family well and pump it all by hand. On an average day, that could mean dozens of trips back and forth, carrying heavy buckets. Water for drinking, water for cooking, water for washing, water for bathing. And even after all that, if you had to use the bathroom, the only place to go was the outhouse.
Your older brothers and sisters always frightened you about the fact that you were going to run into scorpions at night, spiders and things like that if you had to go to the bathroom at night. And I remember being young, being just terrified of getting up and going to the bathroom at night because it was scary. Plus the fact it was cold, especially in the wintertime, you know.
Nighttime came quickly on farms without electricity. It was a quiet time that families spent together reading or doing homework. And there were not many options. It was early to bed, early to rise on the farm because you had to make the most of the daylight hours. But with the opportunity to get affordable electricity, the lives of farm families would never again be the same.
So we knew absolutely that our lives had changed at that moment when the electricity came in. There was light everywhere. We didn't have to huddle together under the canopy or the glow of a single kerosene lamp. There were games that we could play. It was just such a fascinating thing.
President Franklin D. Roosevelt made electricity a reality for rural Americans when he ordered the creation of the Rural Electrification Administration, or REA, in 1935. The REA was an agency that offered low-interest loans to cooperatives, or groups of people in rural areas who agreed to sign up for electricity by paying a $5 membership fee. After enough people had joined each cooperative and the loans were approved by the REA, power line construction could begin, and the loans would be paid back through people's electric bills.
Hoist up the transformer. It means kilowatt hours of electricity. 1 kilowatt hour will do a week's wash or grind 100 pounds of grain. 1 kilowatt hour will hoist 2 tons of hay. Kilowatt hours don't get tired.
For the first time ever, rural people could put away their kerosene lamps. Dim lighting and strained eyes were a thing of the past. Now, a simple flick of a switch could light up a whole room.
But in those days, it was such a remarkable thing, and people were terrified. They didn't know how to handle electricity. My mother refused to plug in an appliance or unplug an appliance without holding one of those pot holders because she was afraid it would burn her or bite her. And that's when we first got electricity, of course.
The days of endless back-breaking labor were over. People were in awe of their new appliances. Dirty wood-burning stoves were replaced by electric ovens. Washboards were set aside for washing machines, which did all the scrubbing for you. And trips to the well were no longer necessary. It was quite a thrill to have running water and indoor plumbing in your own home.
We had neighbors who would come to watch the commode flush because they'd never seen it. They wanted to see it. They would watch the water swirl in the water flush out, you know. It was like a circus event. They just sort of stood in a line in the hall and each one would come in and watch this and they were in awe of it. It was funny now that I think about it, but at the time I remember being so proud that we had an indoor bathroom and we could actually show it off by pushing the lever on the commode and flushing it the water down so that people could stand there and say, boy, look at that. Electricity was a mighty thing.
The wires stretching across the countryside surged with electricity and new opportunities for rural people. With the help of electric tools, farmers could get their work done more quickly with less effort and without as many hired hands. They were now able to produce higher quality dairy products thanks to refrigeration. And electricity even helped increase the amount of food farmers produced. Chickens only lay eggs when it's light out, so farmers were now able to trick them into laying eggs at night by using electric lights. And store owners no longer had to close when the sun went down. The glow of their storefronts was a welcoming sign to people driving by. Stores could sell new electrical appliances and more types of food because of refrigeration. Electricity brought the world to rural families, but there was also something lost.
When I grew up and began my own professional work, I realized that I would never be able to give to my children what my parents gave to me, because my children could not work with me as I worked with my parents in the fields and in the home. And there was a big difference in that.
During its first 50 years, the REA electrified over 99% of rural America. They brought the power to American farms.
And the long day ends. Things will be easier now.
Between 1935 and 1950, over 52,000 miles of power lines were built across rural Georgia.